Welcome back, my dear friends. In this second part, I'm going to show you the glimpse of the research that INMARS pursue to develop these technologies and modalities. Here, development of wet decontamination formulation based on PTERT, butyl calixphorine for the relative emergency. I'm going to show you that how we develop these devices or lotions. For any kind of research, inspiration is required, and inspiration comes from the need. What is the need for decontamination? So in the scenario like disaster, we have to manage that disaster. In case of civilian agent involvement, the disaster management is only possible by the intermediation of decontamination. That is very, very important to note. We need to undertake or contain the toxic spread. That is very, very important. Instant treatment, if you wish to provide an instant treatment to a victim, then the decontamination is must. Because without doing the decontamination, if you allow the victim to go to the OT or something, then because of cross, secondary contamination or cross contamination, the medic and paramedic staff may get contaminated. So decontamination is must for those scenarios. In a scenario like mall where some dirty bomb exploded, then the whole bunch of people will get contaminated. So how will you segregate them? It is not possible there. So you have to provide a decontamination there, because you cannot let a single chance to happen that a person get escaped out of that hot zone into a green zone, then it will spread the contamination to other people who are normally not in the red zone area. Then they are the agents which have a high probability of reacting on the agent which have some moderate to least probability. So in case of high probability agents, the decontamination is must, because otherwise they will cause harmful effect on the human body. Diverse injury pattern. Suppose the victim have an external injury, so the chances of the internalization of any agent, civil agent, is very, very high. So if you know that if something get internalized in a patient, the chances of getting its survival is very, very less. So in that case, the decontamination is required. Otherwise, things may get slip out of the hand. Degradation duration, if it is very high for any similar agent, then the chances of causing harmful effect is very, very high. So decontamination is must. Otherwise, it will allow, it would lead to the victim to get exposed to the harmful effect of CBM decontamination. What are the challenges in the development of decontamination? This is the second important aspect. We know that we need to have an absorbent disposable, that can lead to the less generation of waste material. If the waste material generation is very, very high, then the disposable is also a headache. So we need to develop any decontaminant lotion that able to generate less quantity of waste. I told you in my previous slide on the dilution, the surface runoff is a limitation in dilution. We cannot allow that surface runoff to pass into a municipal waste. Otherwise, it may lead to contamination to more people through the municipal waste pipe distribution. So surface contaminant is a challenge. Mode of contamination is also an issue. If it is contamination through nose, inhalation, then the chances of getting internalization is very, very high. In that case, decontamination is have a very limited success. But in case of if somebody got contaminated through the skin surface, we know that the absorption through skin is very, very low, very low. So the decontamination is very successful on human skin. So the mode of contamination is also a challenge in the development of decontamination devices. How the solvent react you need to have appropriate solvent. In case of water reactor solvent, the dilution is not a solution. So we need to proper selection the solvent. Solvent selection is also very important. Then what is the degradation duration? There is I already talked in the need for decontamination. Then there are three more aspects which we need to understand. That is on-site off and surface decontamination. More very, very important. Because you can open a business activity unless you have a surface decontamination of that area. This is to prevent, to eliminate the cross-contamination. Mass personal decontamination. This is we require to install, deploy the field-based tent setup where you have to take the person to undress first, then undergo a decontamination, and then you have to make him enter into another tent to provide the loose fitting clothes, and then a paramedic and medic staff will inspect that person for any kind of symptoms. The another more challenge is that the limited number of decontaminants. Yeah, if you go and search and scroll in the Google, you will find a very limited number of decontaminants available commercially for the purpose of decontamination. So therefore, it's a challenge, not only for India, for other countries also. There are number of challenges. So whatsoever the any agency or any forces is using that particular decontamination devices, they have certain limitations. Now, like for example, to move forward to our research part, we have chosen a small data set from the published data. In that thing, we have chosen a compound called butat butyl calix-4-arene. It's a compound. And this is a macrocyclic compound containing the four aromatic rings in a wasp like shape. This is the wasp like shape you can see. Then we tested first with the DFT studies, in silico studies. Now, what the genesis of this work is, we know that to the data available in the nuclear serum site, the iodine is a problem. And so far we have an EDT. EDT, we know that it formed complex with cations and very moderate to high binding affinity for the cations. But it does not form complex with iodine. Earlier, we have a decontamination devices based on EDTA, but they were of limited success because we're not able to chelate the iodide. So we need to have a compound which can, form or chelate any kind of thing with iodide. With this genesis, we have started this new approach, and we perform the DFT studies. DFT is basically a methodology in silico studies to understand the complexation. So first, we determine which conformation of calixin is important. So the wasp shape like conformation is the most stable one for the calixin. Then we form the complex with strontium, cobalt, iodine and tellurium, because these are the most widely cations and anion in the nuclear accident sites data. And what we have found, what we have observed, that they form a good complexation with the calix. So now the next target was to investigate or validate these therapeutic studies with the experimental studies. So we form a calixin solution, and then we allow it to titrate with cobalt. So this, in this representative figures, we allowed calixin to titrate with the cobalt from ratio 1:1 to 1:12. And what we have observed, that the series signal of calixin is undergoing a change. since calixarene is a chemical compound, so it would have a CD signal, and change in the CD signal means that the conformation of the calixarene is undergoing a change. Change in conformation is indicative of complexation. So it basically supporting the DFT data. We have further analyzed using the UV and the UV visual absorption study. The UV absorption signal for the galaxy in a 290 nanometer undergo a change. In fact, the absorbance decreased in the presence of strontium. The change in the absorbance with the component little switch shift in the maxima indicative the microenvironment of calixarene is undergoing shift in the presence of strontium. This we further investigate with the fluorescence study. And here at 365 nanometers wavelength, the calixarene fluorescent emission intensity undergo change in the presence of strontium. As the concentration of strontium increase, there was a little bit quenching in the fluorescent intensity of the calixarene. So these all CD, UV visual and fluorescent study indicative that yes, the complexation is there, which validated these studies we have performed with the DFT. Then we carried out the, in order to make it that, can this trap the iodide or any particular ions? So what we have done, we have performed the ICP-MS. So we have a Thermo Fisher high resolution inductively coupled plasma mass spectrometer where we first take the sample, then we digest. In this case of skin sample, we digest with nitric acid and then we mix it with the plasma. So normally if you see through the window, the plasma look like this. It is a flame like thing. The plasma look like this. Then this, after the mixing of the sample with plasma, then it lead to the generation of plasma, and it lead to pass through the MS detector, and then it gives you that what kind of ion is there and in what percentage it is there. So for the ICP-MS study, we have done for the cold analogs of iodine and thallium. So for the iodine, we chose the nuclei is 127, and we know that for the radioactive iodine is 131, but in place of iodine 131, we choose for iodine 127, and similarly for the radioactive part of thallium, we have chosen the cold analog thallium 205. So basically, it gives a this kind of spectra. So based on this spectra value, we try to find out through this count value, we analyze that what is the constant, what is the basically the quantity of the our cation anion and in how much quantity is available. So then we have done for this for cobalt, cesium, strontium, thallium and iodine, and we but we have done that on the rat skin, on the dorsal part of rat, that we apply the cold analog of cobalt, cesium and strontium, thallium and iodine over it. Then we take our lotion and with our calixarene, and then through the cotton we allow it to wipe it off completely. Then we take out the skin, we treat it, we collect it on the Franz diffusion cell, the aliquots part, and we analyze both the skin and the aliquots. And what we have found that over 90% or 90, 95%, this calcium is able to able to take care of these strontium season in strontium and gallium. In fact, in case of iodine, it is 89%, which is not able to, able to, you cannot produce with EDTA. But that was the success story that inspires to move forward. Then we go for the formulation part. So for the solution reactivity, it is better to for other purposes also, we need to develop the formulation. And we know that we do not want any kind of radiochemical agent or radiological agent to pass through the skin. So we need to develop a formulation that not cause any penetration, that not able to interact with the skin. Size of the form of the nanomachine is also very, very important. So this kind of aspect we have taken into consideration before developing a nanoemulsion. So what is a basically a nanoemulsion? So we take a oil, we select a solution in water, an oil and surfactant and post-surfactant, and then we homogenize them, and we have to, by the homogenization, we prepared the nanoglobules. The size of the globules is nano size. The size what we have determined using the DLS, it is 500. Now, why the 500 nanometer is very, very important? Because if it's anything between up to 100 or between 1 to 100, then it can pass through skin. But I don't want my formulation to pass through skin. That's for quite sure. Otherwise, it will lead to internalization of particular radiological agent. So we need to have a size which is has to be more than 100. So for on the safer side, we have make it in a way that can be have a more than 100 nanometer size. So here with the size is around 500. Now the value of the zeta potential was lying to the negative side. It basically shows the like charges are, if the like charges are there, there will be more repulsion pressures between the nanoglobules, so they will not form aggregation. There will be no cohesion between the nanoglobules, so the nanoemulsion is stable. So hence the negative potential in the zeta is indicative that the nanoemulsion is stable. Then we have done the multi-photon confocal microscopy to whether we have a homogeneous phase or heterogeneous phase. But yes, the globules were on was homogeneously distributed. There was no crystal formation is observed in the aqueous phase as a function to increase in the p-tert butyl calyx fluorine concentration. So all these characterization help us in understanding that we have developed a right formulation. Then there are the further method to test the like for example the viscosity of the formulation, the spreadability of the formulation, and the how much they are. So we also normally out the normal experiments for the physicochemical stability, which I have not shown here, but we normally done the analysis up to 6 months. Is my formulation stable up to 6 months? And we also develop data on the shelf life of the nano formulations. So this formulation was found to be good in good shape up to 1 year. So that is the beauty of this formulation. So in the next part, we're going to show you that the skin penetration part. So my question was that is my formulation is penetrating? So what we have done that we have developed the formulation, but we instead of calixin, we prepared the formulation using rhodamine 123. It's a fluorescent dye, and the fluorescent dye basically it shows gives a fluorescence when you if you take out the skin section, skin dissection, and the histopathological slide you develop for the skin, then if you observe through a microscope, and especially to my fluorescent microscope, then you're able to see that how much extent the my formulation has been penetrated through the skin. This is a subcutaneous lesion, so you can see that this up to this level, my formulation has grown. The skin has different layers: subcutaneous, dermis, epidermis, then the deeper part where the blood vessels start. Problem start when my radiological agent penetrate able to through dermis, epidermis, and reach to the blood vessels. Here in this figure, we can easily decipher out that my formulation is not reaching beyond the subcutaneous part. Hence, it is staying away from the blood vessels. So this formulation is very, very safe. It is not being permeating till the blood vessel. Hence, my objective is over. So we have observed up to 1 hour. In 1 hour, this formulation is not permeating further to the blood vessel. Then the next question comes: how, if it is not permeating, why? Why it is not permeating? We know that our skin, under the skin, there is a lipid layer. If we want to permeate anything, we need to de-lipophilize, or mean that you have to, rupture the lipid layer. So in a normal control, if you use any chemical which can able to de-lipophilize or rupture the lipid layer, then you will not find these peaks in the DSC thermogram. So DSC and the DSC thermograms, you can see that they are T1, T2, and T3 peaks. The peaks are basically corresponding to what the lipid present in the skin. Here you cannot see any T1, T2, and T3 because this is a de-lipophilized skin sample. Now, in this A part, we can easily figure it out in the A and B samples. If you take a control skin sample and the skin sample treated with your nanoemulsion, the peaks remains same there. T1, T2, and T3 all are visible. What is basically showing? It's showing that my formulation is not causing any rupture to the lipid layer. If it is not causing any rupture to lipid layer, it means that the permeation is limited. So it is very well validated the fluorescence dye study. This shows again the success of my formulation, that my formulation is not permeating enough to the blood vessels. So hence I can now start my decontamination work. Sorry. Now moving toward the second part, as I told you that in the case of wounded victim or any person with an external injury, the wet decontamination is not recommendable. So they need to have a dry decontamination, and we have developed a dry decontamination wipes for the chemical and biological contamination. So this is basically the what we have done. We have fabricated a wipe by putting the different layers of different compounds stick together. So you can find out that they are 5 layers compound, 5 layer compound, wipes we have prepared, and it is done with using the different textile technologies. So it need to be converted into fibers with the impregnation of zinc titanate and silver nitrate. So we treated them. Then we have characterized these wipes using SEM. SEM basically a microscopic technology that can be used for the by using the secondary electrons, analyze the surface part of any material. So this material, by analyzing this the morphology of this material, you are able to figure it out that what is the true nature of that material. So here the material are found to be very, very, in a fiber form as expected. Fiber is required because in the case of fibers, the absorption is better. Is better. Therefore, we need to have a material in our pipes in form of fiber. This is what, in fact, we can also see the crystals of zinc titanate over them. So this is the beauty of this technique. Then in order to verify what kind of elements are present there, so we have performed the EDEX study also. So the EDEX study shows that it contains carbon, it contains oxygen, it contains titanium, zinc, sodium, aluminium, and so zinc titanate is there. That is basically the message that yes, this fiber is impregnated with the zinc titanate. This we have done in collaboration of Department of Textile, IIT Delhi. Then, since the chemical and biological agents are involved, so we have done the study with the antimicrobial testing, and we chosen two compounds. One is two pathogens. One is Asorius, another is Pigasella pneumonia. And you can see that in the control sample, both are there. But if you treat them with the calixin, then you will hardly find any colony in the factory dish. In fact, if you see the derived data, the control in the blank sample, the colonies were 428, in the control it is 429, and so there was reduction of only 18%. But as you treat this with silver nitrate and zinc titanate in 10% or 4%, you will able to see a bacterial reduction count in 99.62%. That is the beauty of this study, that the zinc titanate as well as the silver nitrate is able to take care of the bacterial the pathogen part if you apply over any surface which contain the bacterial load. So we have done the antifungal study. This is we have done as per the international guidelines. So let me just show you that we have taken the four sample. One is with control, other is silver nitrate. Then in that the third one we have taken the zinc titanate 4%, silver nitrate 1%. Then again the silver nitrate was 1% and zinc titanate was 10%. So what we have done, that we have prepared that while we have impregnated with the zinc, silver nitrate and zinc titanate, then we allow it to keep in the flask which contain the fungus solution. Of the fungus we have taken the penicillium here. So antifungal activity was passive in penicillium. So what we have seen, that there is a fungus there. There's a fungus here, but no such black spots are found in these three samples. So again, it basically showing that this is able, this is an antifungal in nature. So this vibe is very good. It is antibacterial, it is antifungal. Both they have been tested as per the international guidelines. Then for the chemical agent, for the mustard gas, we have selected a simulant called 2-chloroethylphenyl sulfide. This is the structure, except 2-chloroethylphenyl sulfide. Why we cannot use mustard gas? Because to carry out an experiment with mustard gas, you have to have a lab which of have a permission or license from the international body. And again, it required a expertise to tackle mustard gas. So in order to perform the study in normal laboratories, in place of mustard gas, we can have a simulant like 2-chloroethylphenyl sulfide, which have a same effect, but which are not very as much severe as compared to the mustard gas. They also call blisters, but which is easily manageable in normal laboratory or with normal, working experience. So we have chosen the 2-chlorophenyl sulfide study. So 2-chlorophenyl sulfide. This is the 10x image of the rat skin which we have applied with the simulant, and you can see that the large vacuoles are there. And the large vacuoles are there. These are large, vacuoles. If the vacuole size of the skin increases and the stratum corneum is reduces, it means that the skin is ruptured, and soon the blisters will come. But if you apply the nanoemulsion of calixrin after the application of 2-chlorophenyl sulfide, so after the 10 minutes, if you apply it, and then you take out the skin sample and perform the histopathological study on that same skin sample, you will find that this skin sample is almost same as that of control skin sample. Vacuole size is not very high. Stratum corneum is there. Dye is properly stained here. This is a HE dye. The HE dye is properly stained there. So basically the change in the microstructure of skin is not very different as compared to the control sample. Yes, the differences are there. I will not say it will 100% work, but yes, at least 98%, 99% it will work. So they change in the microstructure, but the microstructure change is not as much as happened in the case of the skin sample is only applied with the 2-chloroethylphenyl sulfide. So again, we have performed this for same skin sample. We have performed the SAM study. In the SAM study, the skin treated with 2-chloroethylethyl sulfide without decontamination. So you can see that vacuoles are there. See, vacuole structures are there. And when you applied with the wipes, then the rupturing is not there. The rupturing is not there. Vacuole is not there. So basically, it's suggesting that yes, our wipes are well, is working fine. Our wipes is working fine against the mustard gas simulant. So we expect that it will work against the mustard gas. We also done the study with the nerve simulant also. Why nerve simulant? If you recollect from 2018, 19, and the number of such accident or incident happened, and they only involve the nerve agents. Nerve agents, especially in our country like India, where it is an agriculture society, and many industrial agricultural commodities like for inputs, agricultural inputs in all organophosphorus compound. So now agent attacks are quite expected. So we have tested against the nerve agent also in that respect. Again, in place of a nerve agent, we have chosen phosmate. This is the structure of phosmate. And because of this entity, the nerve agent is very, very deadly because it forms complex with acetylene choline esterase enzyme and affect our nerve system. So if you able to neutralize this particular area, then you able to withstand or neutralize the nerve agent. But for this studies, what we have performed the acetylene choline esterase inhibition assay. So in the contaminated rat, if you apply it and then you collect the blood of sample of that particular rat and then you apply, then perform the assay. What you observe that the acetylene choline esterase is around 90% get inhibited. But if you decontaminate that rat with with your wipe, after 10 minutes, inhibition is very, very low. It is around 2% or somewhere between 2-3%. So it basically emphasizing that, yes, my wife is able to take care of the nerve agents if it is there. So it is completely decontaminated the nerve agents. Again, we have performed that study on the human tissue coolant and the rat skin, because we cannot perform such studies in human beings. It is unethical. So now the science and technology have made much progress in the recent times. And they are the materials available, which is we call human tissue coolant. They are almost of same nature as the human skin. So we have those human tissue coolant, and we have performed this study with the radioactive elements like technetium 99M, which is normally normally study in the scintigraphy study. Then we have a vibrant 131, which we use in the treatment of thyroid. Then the thallium 231 was we have arranged from the AIMS, and we applied that thing on the human tissue coolant. Then we applied with the beacon with the Alexian nanoemulsion, and what it is being observed that in case of the calixarin, which calixarin, the decontamination was over 90%. That is a beauty. That is the beauty of this calixarin lotion, that it works in case of technetium as well as in iodine as well as in thallium. Similarly, if you apply in the rat skin, because rat skin is mean that living system, again my formulation is working against the radioactive element like technetium, iodine and thallium. So this is the beauty of this work, that you actually see, actually observe that what kind of, you know, effects you can observe in case of contamination and decontamination. So now in the last part of my my presentation, I am just focusing on three products. One is Chaschuddhika. So these are the products which are commercially available, and that is why I have taken. There are a lot of products which are at different stage of development, but I'm not going to talk about, because I don't want to confuse my audience. I just want to assure that yes, we are prepared, and we have the right kind of products. They're commercially available. So anybody can go and, you know, check on our website and check out our TOT partners and can directly order for it. So the DRDO have developed a Shuddhika, which is a skin decontamination kit, and it is in the body care decontamination. What is mean the body care basically? So body care means that you require a body. You cannot do your by yourself. And this basically contain, as per the IEA guideline, they are, you know, number of chemicals like K1O4, K2CR2O, then HCl, phosphatidylcholine, then there are the other chemicals which can be normally used in case if anybody get contaminated with radioactivity. So it is used for reducing the radiation load on the skin of the person which is exposed to radiation after the nuclear eventuality. So this is very important. And it has been developed for use by the member of quick response medical team to externally decontaminate the casualty exposed to radioactive contamination. So again, this is a very, you know, it's a kit. Basically, you can see that it have a housing. It contains the kit. It contains the gauze, and everything is there. So you need not to worry about it. Even though you're not listening to my presentation, if you're going to use that thing, so you need not to worry about it. It contains an instruction manual in this form of booklet. Just go by through it one by one, perform the step, and by performing one or two cycles, you're able to take care of the radioactivity. So this is a very, very important DRD project which we have developed In fact, a common man with a little knowledge can use that particular product. So that is the beauty of this product. Then DRDO have developed a earlier we have a personal decontamination kit MK1 Mark 1 where the it is for the absorption of chemical warfare agent for skin or some protection suits, gloves and arms. So the active ingredient was fluoride. Fluoride being the multani metal. We know that multani metal for the beautification purposes. So multani metals have a very good, you know, enriched in minerals. So they can be used for the ion exchange. And that is why the fluoride is being used for the beautification purposes. So seeing that particular aspect, the DRDO have developed a fluoride-based you know, personal decontamination kit for the chemical warfare absorption. And this has been commercially available, but we did a little modification in the DRDO have done a little modification in that kit, and then they use nanomaterials for titanium magnesium with active chlorine compound. So now the efficacy has been improved further. And again, if you have not have a prior knowledge, you can follow the detailed instruction in this booklet, and it is very easy to undergo through these booklets. DRDO have also developed a dye decontamination modules. Like for example, if somebody is wounded and the decontamination is not possible, or if you want to decontaminate small equipments, then this can you keep it in this particular module. This is a IR lamp fitted module. So the IR lamp through the heating, it will take care of decontamination in the material surfaces. Then for the other type of, you know, surface decontamination, they are decontamination lotion. This is to decontaminate the chemical warfare agent, biological agent. So ingredient was sodium hydroxide, ethylene mono, glycol monothiol. So this is the active ingredients, and they able to neutralize any kind of, you know, the chemical warfare agent is there, then it easily, you know, dispose of very, very nicely. So my dear friends, this is the overall I would like to show you that we need not to be, you know, frightened of such kind of things. Our government, our country is thinking about it, and we have a good preparedness in terms of the products and technologies, and they are very easy to use, very easy to operate. And this is how that our institute works, and we 24 by 7, 365 days we work toward the national for the national interest. And I hope so that you like my presentation. If you have any question, please do write to us through our organization, to our organizers, Ramanujan College and Miranda House. I mean, once again, I really thankful to the organization of Ramanujan College and Miranda House for giving me such a wonderful opportunity. It really gives me an immense pleasure to interact with you, such intellectual audience. And if I get another chance, definitely I would love to visit again and interact. Thank you so much.